The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, third chapter, text number 21 through 24, given by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded in the summer of 1966 in New York.
अहवतो सपततोपि गरियान जद्दिभाग्रे नामतु धम। A person, whatever he may, even he is very low born, but if he utters the holy name of God by his tongue, he becomes the glorious person. Sapacha Sopi. Sapacha Sasa means dog. And Patata, Patata means one who eats dog. In India, the dog eaters are considered to be the lowest class of the dog eaters. So Sapachata. Sapachata means the dog eater. See, even the dog eater, even if he is a dog eater, it doesn't matter, if he can chant the holy name of Lord, then he becomes glorious. Ahavato sapajato kidariyan jadighagre namadudham. So this Hare Krishna chanting is glorious, and anyone who chants this, he becomes glorious. Lord Krishna says that jadjada charati sreshtha lokastha sreshtha sattadeva itare janaha sajat pramanam kurute lokastha anuvartate. Jadja, whatever is practice by the principal or the superior in every society, in every country, there are certain class of men who are considered the leaders or the superior men. The Lord Krishna says that whatever is practice by the top list men, that is followed by the ordinary class of men. Sajat pramanam kurute, and the top list man, whatever he adopts, or whatever scripture, or whatever instruction he admits, lokastad anuvartate, ordinary class of men, they generally fall. The whole idea is that Krishna wants Arjuna to become an ideal person. Ideal person. So that ordinary men can follow. And generally, the practice is also the same. Any leader, if the leader of the people, their ideal, his ideal, the leader of the man, if he is ideal, the followers also become ideal. And if the leader of the society or country is not an ideal man, then the followers or the countrymen and the members of the society, they are also on the same time. Now Krishna says, Nami Parthasi Kartabva Sri Sulokesu Kinchana Na Anabhatyam Aptabhyam Bhatta Eva Chakarmani. Now see, Arjuna, I am the Supreme Personality of God. I have nothing to do in this world for gaining something. Everyone does something with the purpose of some gain. Without gain, nobody works. Either spiritual gain or material gain. Somebody works for material gain and somebody works for spiritual gain. There must be some gain. But Lord Krishna, He is the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Supreme Personality of Godhead means He is full with opulence. All opulence. Now, what are the things which generally people aspire after? People generally they want wealth, they want riches, they want to be very highly rich man, accumulate wealth, millions and millions of rupees. Then somebody wants to become very strong man. Somebody wants to become very beautiful man. Somebody wants to become very learned man. Somebody wants to be very famous man. So on. There are six opulences as discussed in this hall many times. Vaisajyasya samagrasya bijasya jasasya sriya. There are six kinds of opulences. Means wealth, strength, beauty, knowledge and renunciation. Renunciation is also considered as opulence. Somebody has got immense money, immense wealth, but at once he renounces everything and becomes a mendicant, for some cause of course. There are many instances in political field. Somebody for political emancipation, he gives us everything, all homely comforts and everything, renounces and becomes a very famous man in the political field. Similarly, there are men in the spiritual field also, they renounce everything for achievement of spiritual perfection. So renunciation is also one of the opulence. So wealth, strength, beauty, knowledge, renunciation. So these things are opulence. Now Lord Krishna, He says that I have nothing to gain all these opulences, but because the definition of God is one who has got in full all these opulences, He is God. The definition of God is like that in the Vedic literature. Everything has got a definition. So the definition of God is that Vaisajyasya Samagrasya, one who possesses full wealth, and full strength, full and fame, full beauty, full knowledge, and full renunciation, and He is God. So Lord Sri Krishna proved, when Lord Sri Krishna was present amongst ourselves, from the history we can see that if we have to believe the history, then He was in full in everything. He was full in everything. So far, as a householder also, when Lord Krishna displayed His capacity as a householder, you will be surprised, perhaps most of you know, that He married 16,108 wives. 16,000. So somebody may be surprised that how a person can marry 16,108 wives. Yes. A ordinary person like us, or a little more strong person, that is not possible. But when the word omnipotency is applied, God is called omnipotency, so for Him, nothing is impossible. So if we have to believe the history, then Lord Sri Krishna married 16,108 wives, and He built 16,108 palaces also, well decorated, fully equipped, all marble palaces, and there was no need of light. The palaces were so nicely decorated with jewels that the light focused by the jewels that would illuminate the house. And another thing, He was present in every house simultaneously. 16,000 wives and 16,000 houses, He was present in 16,000 expansions by Himself. So that is called opulence. These are the opulence. The Lord Krishna was full. Now when Lord Krishna was present on the battlefield of Kurukshetra, He was very old man. He was very old man. Although you see His picture just like a young man of 20 years old. But you have seen, some of you must have seen the picture of Krishna of battlefield. Arjuna is sitting on the chariot and Krishna is the chariot driver. Arjuna and Krishna was of the same age, but Arjuna looks older, Krishna looks younger. And Krishna at that time had great grandchildren. His grandchildren and his grandchildren's children were present at that time, and the whole family extended to about 10 million. So this may be astonishing, but for God is nothing astonishing. If it is a fact that everyone is the son of God, sarvajonishu kaunteya sambhavanti murtayaja, you'll find in the Bhagavad Gita that in every species of life, in whatever form you may see them, I am the father of all of them. Now, if He is the father of all living beings, just calculate how many living beings there are throughout the whole universe or in the creation. In comparison to that, if He displayed that He has only 10 million of sons and grandsons and grandchildren, that was nothing more. So these are things. Krishna was equipped in that way. So He says, Partha, my dear Arjuna, I have nothing to give. Don't think that I am here in the battlefield to assist you just for some remuneration or for some gain. Because I can have anything and everything at my will only. Nami parthasi kartavyam. Therefore, I have no fixed duty. In the Upanishad, you will find the definition of Brahma. Natasatajam karanancha vidyate. The Supreme Brahma has nothing to do. That is the distinction. We have got everything to do. Suppose we want spiritual perfection. So we have to do something. We have to perform something. We have to act practically. You have to go accept penance, you have to accept, just like we are trying to chant, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. So, the idea is that I may be elevated to the perfect position. So, anything, if we desire, we have to do something. But the definition of Brahma and God is that He has nothing to do. The Veda Upanishad says, natasya karyam karanam cha vidyate. He has nothing to do. He still is God. Not that one becomes God by doing something. Nowadays it has been practiced to say that I have meditated so many years, I have undergone so much penance, then I have become now God. Oh, God is not manufactured in that way. God cannot be manufactured. Now Krishna, when he was in the lap of his mother, he was God at that time also. Not that he had to grow up and undergo some penance and austerity and vows and go to the jungle or Himalaya or accept some very great spiritual master and so on, so on. Then he became God, as it has been now the practice, that anyone who that he is little advanced in spiritual life, and if he can display some wonders, oh, he at once becomes God. So God is not so cheap. Simply by playing some wonders. Just like the other day, I narrated the story of Dubhasa Muni. Dubhasa Muni was a great yogi. The yogis can display many wonders. Many wonders. In my childhood, I had got one tutor. So, he was telling about his spiritual master, he was a yogi, that he said that when he visited his spiritual master, who was a yogi, his spiritual master asked him, what do you want to eat? And because my teacher knew that his spiritual master was a great yogi, he wanted to have a taste of pomegranate of Kabul. In India, pomegranate of Kabul, Afghanistan, that is very famous. So, his spiritual master said, yes, you will find it in this room, you can see it. So he saw the dust, it has been taken from the tree of pomegranate and the juice was falling down, you see. So these wonders can be played by yogis. There are many yogis still living. They can manufacture gold. They can manufacture gold. The process is that they can eat, para. What is the English of para? Liquid metal, white?
Mercury.
Mercury, yes. Yes, mercury. They eat mercury. They eat mercury and after the next morning pass urine. And in that urine they put some copper coins, just like you have got said. And when it is heated, the copper coins becomes gold. And it is a chemical, theoretical truth that the mercury, molecules of mercury and molecules of gold are almost similar. Only one molecule is different. So, mercury can be turned into gold. That is a chemical fact. And we have got information from Vedi scripture that formerly gunmetal mixed with mercury could be transformed into gold. So these are some of the chemical process, physical process, which is being done by scientific advancement of knowledge. There are many yogis who can do by yogic form. Just like by physical process, now people are trying to travel in the space, but the yogis can travel in the space very swiftly, more swiftly, swifter than any Sputnik. Just like the other day, I narrated the Dudbhasa Muni travel all over the space in the universe and outside the universe, and he came back within 1 year. So, therefore Krishna's another name is Yogeshwar. Yogeshwar. And there are many yogis and many yogic principles. But Krishna is the master of all yoga. Oh. See, if ordinary yogis, they can display some wonders, so why not Krishna? He is the Yogeshwar, he is the lord of all yogis. So, by performance of this yoga prakriya, or the yogic mystic powers, one cannot become God. God is different from all of them. So Krishna was that God. So he is manifestation, he is what? Now here he says, which I was going to explain from Vedic scripture, that Krishna says, Name Parthasi Kartabham, I have nothing to do. He has nothing to do, still he is so powerful. Yes, that is confirmed in the Vedic scripture that the nature of Brahma is described like this. Natasatajam karanamchivita. The nature of Brahma is that he has nothing to do. He has nothing to do. That is the difference between God and ourselves. We have to do everything to achieve a certain aim. But God has nothing to do. Natasatajam karanamchivita. Natasat sama adhikasta visyate, and nobody is found who is equal to him and or greater than him. Nobody is found. That these are the definition in the Vedas, Vedic literature. That God has nothing to do. Nobody is equal to him and nobody is greater than him. That means everyone is below him. Everyone is below. Nobody can be equal with God. Even such great demigods like Shiva and Brahma, they are considered to be the highest demigods. Still, in the scriptures it is said that nobody should place all these demigods, even Shiva and Brahma, on equal footing with Vishnu. Vishnu, the Supreme Personality of God, a Krishna. So Krishna has nothing to do. God, who is actually God, he has nothing to do. He has nothing to do. He is God from the very beginning. And he is all powerful with all opulences. That is the God. So Krishna says, I have nothing to do. Trishu lokesu kincha. Not only in this earth, but in the three worlds, anywhere I can go, anywhere I can walk, anywhere I can see, but still I have nothing to do. Na anavapyam aptabhyam. It is not that am deficient in my possession. We walk because we find deficient thought in any power, in any either spiritual power or material power. We have to work because we are deficient. So Krishna is not deficient. So that he has to fill up the deficiency. No. Still, bhakto eva cha karmani. Now he says that, Arjuna, you see that still I have engaged myself in the worldly duties. Why? Just to become the ideal man. Although he was not man, he was God. Because he was playing the part of a man, therefore, he was taking part in the battlefield. He has nothing to gain out of it, personally. But why he was taking part in the battlefield? Just for the right cause. So, he wanted to establish that for right cause, there must be fighting. You cannot abolish violence from the world. This is the instruction of Krishna in Bhagavad Gita. If required, violence will be taken. As Krishna induced Arjuna to be violent. Arjuna wanted to be non-violent, but he wanted that you should, you must fight. This fight is arranged by me. So these are the examples. Nothing is bad, nothing is good. If it is not purpose, that is the whole purpose of teaching Bhagavad Gita. Nothing is good, nothing is bad. Everything is good, everything is bad in this material world. But we have to see, just like the common phrase goes, the end justifies the means. And that is Krishna teaching here, that he has nothing to gain. He is full in himself. But just to set examples in the world, he was taking part in the fighting because he wanted to establish it, that fighting for good cause should not be avoided. That was his mission. Then further he says, Jadi hi ahangana bhaktiyang jatu karman napandritaha Mamo vatmanu vartante manushya patha sarvasaha. Manushya, now, just see, here it is said, manushya means all men. All men. So Krishna is not for a particular society or particular religious community or particular country or particular time. No. Krishna is the leader of all men for all the time in all the countries, in all the worlds and all the universes. So he is not a sectarian personality of God. He should not. Manushya it is fuller number. All men. So he said, if I do not set example by my practical work, then because I am the leader of all men, all living entities, they will be wrongly directed. Now actually we see also, at least in India, we have got this experience. Now the Bhagavad Gita, we must always remember that it is being taught in the actual battlefield. Now, it's a great personality like Mahatma Gandhi. He wanted to prove from Bhagavad Gita non-violence. He was in favor of the doctrine of non-violence. Now, you have seen Mahatma Gandhi's picture, that he is always standing with Bhagavad Gita like this. So Bhagavad Gita was his life and soul, practically. And in the morning he was having Bhagavad Gita class, in the evening he was having Bhagavad Gita class. So that was his life and soul. But unfortunately, he interpreted Bhagavad Gita in his own way. Although he took Bhagavad Gita as his life and soul, so but he interpreted it in his own way. That is not the way of understanding Bhagavad Gita. Therefore, now such a great man and such a good man, he was not only a great man, he was a very good man in the world, worldly estimation. His character, his behavior, his dealing, everything was good, was ideal personality. But just see, he was killed by violence. He could not stop violence.
He was killed by violence?
Yes. He was killed by violence. And his idea, he wanted to make Hindu-Muslim unity in India. The British government fabricated the Hindu-Muslim riot. And at last also, their purpose was fulfilled by partition of India, Pakistan and India. Now, Mahatma Gandhi worked throughout his whole life just to make a unification of the Hindus and Muslims. Unfortunately, at last he had to see that the Hindus and Muslims of India were divided into Pakistan and India. And his non-violence also failed. So, because if we do not follow the right person, Mahajana Jina Gatasya Pantha, then however I may be great in the estimation of the innocent public, that is wrong path. Therefore, the right thing is to follow the succession. Now, we have to follow the principle which Krishna said. Krishna is not advocating, I mean to say, non-violence. You cannot eradicate violence from this world. That is not possible. Because Krishna himself is on the battlefield and he is trying to induce Arjuna. Arjuna is declining and he is inducing. No, you must fight. So, we have to follow the footprints of great personality. Dharmasya tatva nihitam guhaya Mahajan. In Srimad Bhagavatam, you will find that it has been advised that religious principles should be followed by taking the life examples of great personalities. Religious principles, it has been described in the Bhagavatam, that tatko apatishya, if you want to establish religious truth, you cannot establish it by your logic and argument. It is not possible. Because I may be a very perfect religious man, but I may not be a very good arguer, another strong man who can argue very strongly, who knows logic very nicely, he can defeat me, he can make my whole conclusion null and void. So therefore, simply by argument, a logical conclusion, one cannot reach to the truth, to the religious truth. It is not possible. Tatko apratishtha sutayo vibhinya. Sutaya means reveal scriptures. Just like in the world there are many revealed scriptures, there are Vedas, Puranas, the Bible, the Quran, and There are so many religious scriptures also, and if you go on reading them, although the aim is one, still you will find some discrepancy from one to another. Sutayo bivinna. Bivinna means they are diverse. Sutayo bivinna, naso munidyasya matang navinyam. And so far philosophers are concerned, one philosopher tries to defeat another philosopher. That is the philosophical way. Nasum nidyasamatang navinnam dharmasatatang nihitam guhaya. Therefore, this truth of religion is very confident. Nihitam guhaya. Guhaya means very confident. So how to know it? The Mahajana Jina Datasya Pantha. You just try to find out great men of religious life, and you just try to follow. Now, you may have in your own ideas some great men. You know, they are also checked in the Srimad Bhagavatam. 12 different personalities have been described, that these persons are great men. So we have to follow their principles and or their any principle in their disciple succession, then we can fulfill. The same thing is here also described, that Vedacharati Srishta Lokaspad Anubhasati. And Sri Krishna himself, undoubtedly Sri Krishna is the greatest personality in those days and still now also, still in all, not only in India, in all parts of the world, Sri Krishna is accepted as the greatest leader of philosophical presentation of this Bhagavad Gita. Every nation, every country reads it very minutely. So undoubtedly he is a great leader. Now if we follow Krishna, not only we are chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, but we have to follow the principles laid down in the Bhagavad Gita. That will make our life successful. Practically, we have to apply. We have to apply the principles. Otherwise, and the whole attempt will be a failure. That is explained in the next verse. Ussidi, ussideyu ime loka, na pujya karma sedaham, sankara satakatya shyama, upahanyami imapta jaha. If I do not place idea before the living entity, praja, praja means those who have taken birth, they are called praja. Ja means birth. Ja, janma, janma. And praja, prakishti rupena ja. Anyone, praja, just like in a state, it is called praja or citizen, who have taken the birth in that particular place. So similarly, Lord Krishna says that if I do not set example in my life, then there will be unwanted population, unwanted population. And actually, that has become now in the present world, by not following the principles of God consciousness or Krishna consciousness, we have got now unwanted population. Unwanted population. Here it is plainly written, Sankara Sacha Katta Shyama. Sankara Sacha means cross-breeding. Sankara Sacha. According to Vedic rites, the breeding of child is very nicely enunciated. That is called Garbhadhan Sanskar. Garbhadhan Sanskar. Before begetting a child, one has to perform some ceremony just to make his mind completely pure and sanctified. Both the husband and wife become sanctified and then they take part in sex life, and that child comes out a very nice child. So from the very beginning of the birth, there are systems how to beget a good population. So these things are there. Now, Krishna says that if I do not place the ideal life, then the population will be sankara. Sankara means unwanted, creating disturbances always. There will be no peace in the world, and actually we are feeling that there is no peace in the world. Why? Because the population has become unwanted. And by increasing such population, the natural sequence will be, there will be some disease, there will be some famine, or there will be some war when the population will be vanquished. That is the law of nature. That is accepted in economics also, Malthusian theory, whereas most of you know whenever there is unwanted population, these three things will naturally, by nature's course, will appear. Famine, pestilence and war, and the population will be finished. So there was some unwanted population at that time also, for which Krishna arranged the war, battlefield of war. Battlefield of war. So we have to first, if we want very good population, very good generation, then we have to follow the principles of Bhagavad Gita. The principles of Bhagavad Gita is ultimately described, as we will find in the last day. Sarva-dharmān paritajya māmekaṁ saraṇaṁ vraja. Aham tvāṁ sarva-pāpibhyo mokkhayiṣyāmi mā śuchaṁ. That is the real religion. Now, in the fourth chapter, you will find that Lord says that I come down in this as incarnation. Jadadahi dharmasya glani bhavati bharat. I come down. Whenever there is some flaw in the religious principles, jadadahi dharmasya glani bhavati bharat, abhutthanam adharmasya. The flaw in the religious principle means advancement of irreligiosity, abhutthanam adharmat. Paritranaya sadhunam vinasaya cha duskritam. Paritranaya sadhunam. Sadhu means who are actually following the religious principles. They are called sadhu. Sadhu means good man. There is description of sadhu also. Titik sava, karunika, Srida, Sarvabhutana, Ajata, Satrava, Shanta, Sadhava, Sadhu Husara. Sadhu, one who is called Sadhu. Sadhu means Titiksava. Titiksava means a very tolerant, very much tolerant. Titiksava, karunika, at the same time very kind hearted. We find these two characters in the life of Lord Jesus. He was very much tolerant, at the same time kind to the people, generally, you see. So, titiksava karunika srida sarvahutanam. And his friend, a sadhu, is friend of all living entities. He is not only friend of the humankind, he is friend of the animals, he is friend of the trees, he is friend of the ants, worms, reptiles, serpents, everyone. Titiksava karunika srida sarvahutanam. And ajata satru, and because he is friend of everyone, he has no enemy. But unfortunately, the world is so infidel, even to such a sadhu, there is enemy. Just like Lord Jesus Christ had some enemies, and Mahatma Gandhi had also some enemies, so who killed him? So the world is such traitorous. shameless sadhu, he has some enemies, you see. But sadhu, from his side, he has no enemies. He is friend of everyone. Titiksara karunika srida sarvabhutanam. And ajata satrava shanta, always peaceful. These are the qualities of sadhu, saintly persons. So, now it comes down. Paritranaya sadhuna, his special purpose of coming down as incarnation, is to save the sadhus, because sadhus are always persecuted by the demons, the demonic class, the atheist class. They're always prepared to persecute the sadhus. The Lord comes, paritranaya sadhuna, just to protect the sadhus or the saintly persons and vinashaya to duskrita and to vanquish the miscreants. That is the mission. When Lord Krishna comes, or any incarnation of Lord comes, actually, not so-called advertised incarnation, I mean to say, he'll find all the incarnations and the Vedic literature, they are named there. Not that anyone can manufacture himself as incarnation. Every incarnation is mentioned in the Vedic scripture. When and how, what kind of work he will do, and what a place, which place, and everything in detail is there. So that there is chart of the incarnation. Nobody can become an incarnation beyond that chart. There is chart. Just like there will be an incarnation of Kalki, as several times said, spoken before you, which will take place about 4 millions of years later on. Still, his name is mentioned in the Bhagavad, and the place is also mentioned, his father's name is also mentioned. This is called incarnation. The Lord comes as incarnation for these two purposes. To protect the saintly person, and to annihilate the atheistic demons, and to establish the real purpose of religion. Now, the point was that what is the real purpose of religion? That real purpose of religion, now, Krishna says that I am descent for establishing the purpose of religion. Paritranaya. Yada yada hi dharma sagrani bhavati. Dharma samasthapana khaya. Paritranaya sadhanam vinashaya cha duskritanam. Duskritanam. These two things. And the third thing is dharma samasthapana khaya. And for the purpose of establishing the principle of religion. Now, in the last word, he says that sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam saranam bhaja. You give up all kinds of religion that you have manufactured. You simply surrender unto me. The religious principle means to surrender unto God and nothing more but that. That is the real principle of religion. Religion without God consciousness, that is no religion, at least according to Bhagavad Gita. Without God consciousness, without establishing my relationship with the Supreme Lord, there cannot be any religious principle. You may go on advertising some new kind of religious principle every day and every moment that is being manufactured in all over the world. And there are so many groups of religious principles, but here, according to Bhagavad Gita, a real religious principle means to establish your lost relationship with the Supreme Lord. We are eternally related with the Supreme Lord, just like the Father and the Son is eternally related. That relation cannot be cut off. A father may become, a son may become rebellious to his father, But he cannot say that he is not my father. Is it possible? No, that is not possible. How can it be possible? I may disagree with my father in so many points of view, but if somebody asks you, who is your father? Oh, I'll have to say, this time any. Oh, I've taken as my enemy. Similarly, as the father and the son, the relationship cannot be cut off. Similarly, our relationship with the Supreme Lord cannot be cut off. It is not possible. If we want to cut off our relationship with the Supreme Lord or God by artificial means, then the result will be that we shall be more and more unhappy. Therefore, the principal business of the human civilization is to establish, re-establish the lost relationship. The world is suffering by this lost relationship, godless civilization. That should not be tolerated. People should be taught, they should revive their God consciousness or Krishna consciousness by all means, and then they will be happy. That is the whole principle. Lord Krishna says that Ussideyu ime lokan kujya karmachir ham sankarasya chakarta shyama upahanyami ma praja. If I do not set examples in this way, then the whole population of the world will be contaminated and there will be unwanted population, and then the whole world will appear just like hell. It is not, it will be inhabitable for good man. Therefore, he says, Satya karmani vidyāṃsa jathā kurvanti bhārata. Satya karmani avidyāṃsa jathā kurvanti bhārata kujyād vidyāṃsa tathā satya cikirsu loka saṅgraham. Cikirsu loka saṅgraham. Now somebody is fighting for some personal gain. Now, at the present moment, sometimes fighting takes place for some personal ambition. Fulfill some personal ambition. That should not be the case. To fulfill one's personal ambition, any risky thing should not be taken. Krishna says, just like foolish people, they work being too much attached for their sense gratification. Similarly, those who are learned, those who are advanced in spiritual knowledge, they also may work similarly, but not for the purpose of sense gratification. How it is possible? Just like a mercantile man is doing some business and working very hard day and night to accumulate some money. Similarly, a devotee of the Lord also can earn money in the same spirit, working day and night superficially. It will appear just like this man and that man, there is no difference. They are working the same and day and night for earning some money. But the devotee or the man who is established in relationship with God, his expenditure will be different. His expenditure will be not for sense gratification, for advancement of God consciousness. That is the ideal man. There is no harm if you work very much attached to your business or anyone. That doesn't matter. The same thing that we have explained and before, that the result should be given to God. That's why Rupa Goswami. Rupa Goswami, the other day I cited the example, when they retired, they brought home two boats full of gold coins, the millions of these. But before retirement, they spent 50% of the accumulation of wealth for God's cause. And 25% he distributed to the relatives. They also expect some money. And 25% they kept in the bank for personal needs in some extraordinary time. So, here Krishna also says, the satta karmani abhidyansa, just like fool, those who have after sense gratification, as they are working with full attachment, that I must have this money, I must accumulate this bank balance and so on, so on. So similarly, jatha purvanti bharata, as they do work, similarly vidyans means learned also, may work in that way. But you spend the money in such a way, that is example. That is example. That example, such a big man, such a rich man, he distributed his money, just like Rupa Goswami. He distributed his money like this. Therefore, those who are devotees, those who are following the principles of devotion, they see the ideal. Well, our former acharya or former devotee, guru or spiritual master, he had so much money and he distributed in this way. The distribution money was accepted. So people would follow them. So Krishna advises Arjuna that you also become an ideal man, that you become a fighter for the cause of God. Then you become the ideal man. Your principle will be followed by others. And that is what I want, and that's what I am instructing. Thank you very much. Now, if you have any questions, one is checked from doing his rightful duty. That is real violence. And some years ago, at Jhansi, I was not in the sannyasi days, I went there and by invitation of some friends, and they wanted to give me some lectures. That was Gandhi's birthday, and they asked me to speak on some non-violence. So I spoke that violence means that to check a person from the discharge of his duties. That is violence. That was my viewpoint. Yes. Now, every man has got his prime duty of life. If that duty is checked, that is violence. So, I wanted to place, and that is a fact from Vedic literature, that human life is meant for realization of God consciousness or re-establishing his relationship, lost relationship with God. This is the claim of every human being. Human being, I have several times explained to you, the human being is distinct from animal life in this way, that animals, they do not know what is the aim of life. The human life is meant for realizing, self-realization. If any civilization that is checking people's progress in the matter of self-realization, that is the most virulent type of violence. So, because people are being checked from the natural advancement of life, this human life is a point when one has to end all the miseries of material existence. That is the aim of human life. If people are not educated to that life, if people are misled in other ways, that is the greatest violence committed to the population. According to to the scripture, they are called Atmaha. Atmaha means suicide. There is a nice verse that just like this material world is accepted as a great ocean. Now, to cross over a great Atlantic Ocean from New York to Portugal, just like Columbus came. Now we have got great big ships, but he had to face many dangers. Just it is very difficult to cross over the Atlantic Ocean and the Pacific Ocean. But if you have got a very good vehicle, ship or anything else, you can very nicely cross over. Similarly, the example is given that this material life is a great ocean. And this human body is a good boat. This human body is a good boat for crossing this ocean. And the spiritual master is a good captain, you see. And the instruction of Lord Krishna, or a similar instruction, bathing instruction, are favorable wind. Just like if you want to cross the Atlantic Ocean from New York, if the wind is blowing westward, then your journey becomes very favorable. So, the favorable wind is blowing by this instruction of the Veda. And there are many stalwart acharyas who are just like the captain, and this human body is just like a good seed. Now, the living soul who is seated in such a favorable condition, if he does not cross over the material ocean, then he is making suicide. Saiva Atmaha. So we have to take advantage. We have to take advantage of this favorable condition to end this miserable material existence. And if anyone does not take the advantage, then he is committing suicide. That is the version of Bhagavad. Or either he personally is committing suicide, or any civilization which is checking this process, that is also violent, the most virulent type of violence, because people are misled. So this is the idea of the scripture, that human life should be utilized only for spiritual self-realization.